மார்க்கெட்டோட நிலவரமேல போங்க கீழ வரும் இந்த ட்ரெண்ட் எல்லாம் பார்த்து அசப்படாதீங்க கொஞ்சம் கொஞ்சமா நீங்க பண்ணுங்க இன்வெஸ்ட் கனவு எல்லாம் நினைவாக்குங்க இதுதான் பெஸ்ட் ஸ்மார்ட் மற்றும் சிம்பிள் ஃபிலோசஃபி ஸ்மார்ட் மக்களுக்கு இதுதான் ஐடென்டிட்டி டெஸ்ட் பண்ணு நீ ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு நீ சிஸ்டமேட்டிக் இன்வெஸ்ட்மெண்ட் பிளான்ஸ் அண்ணா சொல்றத கேளுங்க அண்ணா ஸ்மார்ட்டா ஆகுங்க ஸ்மார்ட்டா வேலை பண்ணு SIP ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு ஸ்மார்ட்டா வேலை பண்ணு SIP ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு பண்ணனும்மா 350 சிசின் சவாரி இல்ல செகண்ட் ஹனிமூன்ல ஆப்பிரிக்கன் சஃபாரி கட்டணும்மா ட்ரீம் ஹோம் இன் டவுன் பேமெண்ட் இல்ல செக்யூர் பண்ணனும்மா ராக்கிங் ரிட்டையர்மென்ட் பிளான் பண்ணனும்மா உங்க ஃபாரின் ட்ரிப் நான் செய்ய வேண்டியது ஸ்டார்ட் தி சிப் ஸ்மார்ட்டா வேலை பண்ணு SIP ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு ஸ்மார்ட்டா வேலை பண்ணு SIP ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு ஸ்மார்ட்டா வேலை பண்ணு SIP ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு ஸ்மார்ட்டா வேலை பண்ணு SIP ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு
மியூச்சுவல் ஃபண்ட் முதலீடுகள் சந்தை அபாயங்களுக்கு உட்பட்டவை. முதலீடு செய்யும் முன்பு திட்டம் சார்ந்த ஆவணங்களை கவனமாக படிக்கவும்.
Carefully.
A very good evening and warm welcome to everyone. I would like to thank all the participants for joining us today. We have over 2,000 registrations for this webinar. We welcome you to the Smart Investor webinar titled Managing Your Debt Fund Investments, presented by ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund and Business Line. I would like to welcome our esteemed speakers today, Renu Narayan, Regional Head, Karnataka, ICICI Pru AMC. We welcome you, Renu. We also have with us Piyush Gupta, Director of Fund Research, CRISIL. We welcome you, Piyush.
Thank you.
I would now like to hand over the discussion to Renu from ICICI Pru MF to kickstart the webinar with her presentation. Over to you, Renu.
Thank you, Radhika. A very warm welcome to all the participants to the second edition of Smart Investor series jointly organized by Hindu Business Line and ICICI Prudential AMC Limited. In the first edition, we had covered how retail investors can make different investment strategies for retail investors to make make wealth for themselves. In this edition, our endeavor would be to take you through debt as an asset class, starting from its basics to how to invest and how to manage your debt investments. One second. So to start with, let us see the importance of fixed income as an asset class. Today, as an investor, you have multiple options to park your savings or surplus funds into different asset classes like equity, real estate, gold, and fixed income. By nature, the returns of equity, real estate, and gold has been seen as cyclical. We have had time periods, sometimes even extended time periods when real estate, equity, or gold would have given very good returns or no returns or even periods of negative returns. And I'm sure some of you would have experienced this in one of these asset classes, one or the other of these asset classes. This brings us to the importance of fixed income as an asset class. Fixed income is one asset class where we can expect steady returns in comparison to rest of the asset classes at different points in time. And I'm sure most of you are very familiar with fixed income instruments like gold, I'm sure most of you are very familiar with fixed income instruments like a bank fixed deposit, a bank savings account, a bond, etc. Through this session, we will make an endeavor to take you through the benefits of fixed income investing, specifically through the mutual fund route and the importance it has in the overall investment portfolio of an investor. So what is the importance of fixed income as an asset class? We all know that equity as an asset class can be very volatile. There are times when we would have seen a stock price moving up and the very next day we see the price of the stock coming down as well. In contrast, fixed income as an asset class has the ability to generate steady returns, and they are in comparison less volatile and displays stability in its price movements. If we put all our money into one asset class, our returns will be totally dependent on the prospects of that one asset class. Debt mutual funds or debt investments, debt fixed income as an asset class is a very good diversification from equity, as it has the potential to generate returns across all market cycles. The other interesting features of fixed income investing would be the ability that it has to generate, generating steady cash flows, the flexibility that it offers in terms of choosing from a wide range of products that can suit your different investment time horizons. For all these reasons, we believe that fixed income is an extremely important asset class and adds value to your overall investment portfolio, and hence should be central to your overall investment portfolio. So what are the different avenues within fixed income as an asset class? Today, we have multiple investment options within the fixed income framework itself, starting from a public provident fund to a post office savings to a traditional investment option like a bank savings account or a bank fixed deposit, tax-free bonds, non-convertible debenture, etc. Of all these options available, fixed income product stands out in terms of, within the fixed income space, a debt mutual fund stands out in multiple ways, starting from the different options, the wide range of products it offers for different investment time horizons, the tax benefit it offers for staying invested for more than 3 years, and the high liquidity that it offers. We will cover each of these details in detail as we go along. While it is very well known and accepted that debt mutual funds offer much superior tax efficiency compared to traditional investment options. There are certain other features which are less known or less acknowledged, like it offers high liquidity compared to traditional investment options. What we mean is that these days you have most of the debt mutual funds comes with no lock-in period. So it offers much higher liquidity compared to a traditional investment. Of course, as an investor, one has to be mindful of the exit load if applicable to the specific scheme that you are invested in. It has the ability to generate better returns on a gross basis because they are very actively managed. It also offers the flexibility to choose from a wide range of products that is available to suit different investment time horizons of yours. So what are the advantages? You know, I touched upon briefly some of these points. To summarize, what gives debt mutual funds an edge over traditional investment avenues? Let's have a look at them. One can invest for time periods ranging from one day to multiple years by choosing the relevant type of debt fund. It offers you multiple modes of entry and exit. As an investor, you can invest a lump sum amount, you can make incremental purchases, you can invest in small amounts through the systematic investment plan periodically. You have the option to switch between schemes. You can invest into a debt fund as a source of funds for doing systematic transfers into equity. Similarly, it offers multiple conveniences and options when it comes to withdrawals or redemptions from mutual funds also. Debt mutual funds are also useful for investing both in rising interest rate as well as falling interest rate scenario because they are actively managed, and it uses multiple strategies to manage these interest rate fluctuations. Debt mutual funds are transparent. Now, what do we mean by transparency? Before one invests into a debt mutual fund, you need to understand the investment objective of the scheme. Post-investing or even otherwise, you can track where the mutual fund scheme is investing its money by seeing the portfolio published in the monthly fund fact sheet, which gets published on a monthly basis. You can also track the valuation of your investments on a daily basis because the NAV or the price of a unit of a mutual fund scheme gets published on every business day. So because of this transparency, it is possible for an investor today to monitor and track his investments at whatever frequency he wishes to and take investment decisions around it accordingly. Debt mutual funds also offer indexation benefit for investment for tenures which is equal to 3 years or more. Now, what do we mean by indexation benefit? To illustrate the advantages of indexation benefit, I have on my screen two cases of investments, one into a debt mutual fund and the other one into a traditional investment. So we have taken an example of two investments of the same amount invested on the same day and redeemed on the same day 3 years later. What we can observe is that, we have assumed the same rate of return as well for both the investments, the mutual fund scheme as well as a traditional debt product. Since the rate of interest is the same, we can see the redemption value is also the same. Now, what is interesting to note is that since the debt mutual fund investment has stayed for more than 3 years, it can avail of what is called as the indexation benefit, which And the tax rate at which the tax liability of the investor would be at the rate of 20% with indexation benefit, which makes the tax outflow for the investor much lower in a debt mutual fund compared to that of a traditional investment, leading to better post-tax returns as well. So what do we mean by indexation? An indexation is nothing but availing of adjusting the cost price of your investment to inflation and then calculating the gain. If we look at the same example, we've invested 1 lakh rupees into a debt mutual fund and a traditional investment product. Both are delivering same returns. The redemption amount is one and the same. While the returns of a traditional investor is calculated straight away by subtracting the current value and the investment amount. In this case, since the investment is completed 1 year, we can calculate the present value of the 1 lakh rupees that was invested 3 years ago. And we can see the current cost of investment adjusted to inflation increases and becomes 1,16,000. So reducing the overall gain considerably, leading to better post-tax returns. So that explains the benefits of indexation. Now that we have seen the benefits of investing and how a mutual fund is positioned within the fixed income framework, let us move on to see what are the different sources of debt fund returns. A debt fund manager endeavors to deliver returns by investing into different debt securities like government securities, treasury bills, commercial papers, certificate of deposits, corporate bonds of different tenors and different maturities, as per the investment objective of the scheme. The main source of returns for a debt mutual fund is accrual income. Now, what is accrual income? Accrual income is the everyday coupon or the everyday accrual income you get from holding a particular instrument. Or in simple language, it is basically the yield or the coupon that you get for holding an instrument till its maturity. The second source of income is capital appreciation that happens when interest rates comes down. The endeavor of a fund would always be to generate both interest income as well as capital appreciation. But we do see certain time periods when accrual income would be more dominant, and we see capital appreciation becoming the more dominant component of returns in an interest rate falling environment, like in recent times. So what do we mean when we say that debt funds deliver better than normal returns when interest rates fall? To understand that, we need to understand the impact of interest rates on bond prices. If you look at the first seesaw, you can see that in an interest rate rising scenario, the price of a bond falls. Similarly, in an interest rate, when you look at the second seesaw, in an interest rate falling scenario, the price of a bond increases, leading to capital appreciation and leading to better returns in an interest rate falling environment. Now, there are different instruments that a debt fund invests into, different instrument types like government securities, corporate bonds of credit rating, AAA, AA or A, and many more instruments. What we may observe is that each of these instruments react differently to interest rate movements, and each of these instruments carry a different risk profile. What do we mean by interest rate risk? In simple language, how the price of the particular bond reacts to movements in interest rates in the economy. And what does credit risk mean? Credit risk basically indicates the risk profile or the credit worthiness of the issuer of the bond. Now, since all these instruments react differently to both these features that we spoke of, which is interest rate risk and credit risk, the major driver for returns of all these instruments also varies. So government securities as well as the AAA rated securities are a greater source for generating capital appreciation, and the AA or the A rated securities are greater source of generating accrual income since they carry a higher yield in comparison to the other two securities for the same yield. So depending on the weightage of each of these instruments in a mutual fund portfolio, the return characteristics also changes for a fund from being primarily accrual or primarily capital appreciation oriented or a combination of the two. So that would be the takeaway for the investors from this particular slide. Now we move on to discussing the entire spectrum of debt mutual fund products that are available for different investment time horizons, for different risk profiles, and for different return expectations. The liquid funds, the funds that fall under the liquid, overnight, or the ultra short category are the funds with the shortest tenor amongst all funds in the debt mutual fund category. And they are funds who generally deliver relatively stable returns as well. Hence, they are ideally suited for short-term parking purposes. Similarly, funds that fall under the low duration or the short duration fund categories also have the potential to generate steady returns if we match our investment time horizon with the underlying maturities of these funds, and are suited for parking of funds, for opportunistic investments into other asset classes, for parking your funds for some expenditure that is just a few months away. Basically, for any kind of short-term parking of funds, you may choose to invest in funds that fall under these categories of like low duration or short duration. From a pure investment purpose, you may choose to invest in funds that follow different strategies like accrual orientation or dynamic duration strategy. This particular slide basically talks about all the 16 categories of funds as defined by SEBI. These funds may be broadly divided into duration-oriented classification as well as instrument-oriented classification. Some of the examples of the duration-oriented classification would be a liquid fund, a low-duration fund, a short-duration fund, or a medium-duration fund. These are funds where the regulator, that is SEBI, has defined the duration range within which these funds have to be managed. Similarly, the examples of instrument-based classification would be a money market fund, a corporate bond fund, a credit risk fund, or a gilt fund, where the regulator has defined the minimum percentage allocation to different instrument types. So these are the 16 categories of funds that are available for you to pick and choose as per your time horizon, your risk appetite, as well as your return expectation. For ease of understanding, we've also classified these funds based on investors' needs. Like, you know, if your need is liquidity or short-term parking, you may choose funds accordingly. Similarly, we've also classified these funds based on the underlying strategy like accrual orientation or dynamic duration. I've listed down the list of fund categories that fall under or, you know, that can satisfy each of these needs with the features. I would request you to just have a glance over these because I'm sure we will be taking it up in detail during the next session as well. So you have funds that are useful for short-term temporary cash management purposes. We have funds that are suitable to park money for the medium to long-term duration. We have accrual-oriented funds under which the credit risk fund falls, which have the potential to generate better risk-adjusted returns. And these are known to be less volatile compared to rest of the funds. Similarly, we have the dynamic duration strategy, which are suited for long-term investments and tries to benefit out of interest rate movements because they have the flexibility to invest across durations. Now we move on to risk management. Risk management is one of the most important aspects of mutual fund investing. And this is a topic that whose importance has come to the fore in recent times because of certain events that have happened in the capital market. Risk as such is not a bad word, and we need to always remember that on the other side of risk is returns. It is important as an investor for us to understand the risk management philosophies as well as the risk management practices that a fund uses to give its investors a very good investment experience. So in this session, we will try to understand some of the best risk management practices and the role played by liquidity and diversification to mitigate some of these risks. So what are the dimensions of risk management? Liquidity management, concentration management, credit management, and duration management. And each of these is very important, and we will look at each of these one after the other. The first and the most important dimension would be liquidity management. What do we mean by liquidity? When an investor comes and redeems his investment, is the fund able to meet the redemption within the specified TAT? That is the fund able to return the funds within the specified TAT? That's what we mean by liquidity in simple words. So what does a fund manager do? A fund manager allocates a percentage of his assets into liquid securities, highly traded securities like AAA, government securities, cash, etc., to cater not only to redemption pressures, but also to create liquidity within the fund to make use of it as and when new investment opportunities come up. A fund manager also could stagger maturities of different papers so that liquidity gets automatically created in the portfolio at various intervals. We move on to the next dimension, which is concentration management. Just as we say that, you know, investors should not put all their eggs in the same basket, a fund manager also endeavors to diversify his exposure to multiple securities without having any skewness towards a specific security or a specific sector. In fact, a regulator also plays a role in defining the sector level limits. So that is extremely important. And just as we say that it is important to diversify your investments at a sector level or at a group level or at a company level, it also helps if there is diversification at an investor level also, so that no one investor or no group of investors, when they redeem at one go, does not create any liquidity stress for investors in the portfolio. So this can be done by limiting the maximum investor per investor in any mutual fund scheme. We move on to the third dimension of risk management, which is credit management. This is, of course, very important and very central to any mutual fund risk management process. The key aspect of credit management would be identifying the right company to lend money to. And this is done based on inputs taken from external credit rating agencies through internal due diligence, internal evaluation process, understanding the quality of the promoter and the management and their ability and willingness to repay. A credit even happens, or a credit default happens, when there is a default in repayment, or if there is any delay in receiving the payments that you have lent to a company. So to mitigate these risks, definitely continuous monitoring, periodic monitoring of these companies definitely helps. We move on to the fourth and the last aspect of duration of risk management, which is duration management. So interest rate risk is something that is a part of almost all debt mutual fund schemes. And it is important that fund managers employ strategies to manage this efficiently. There are these dynamic duration schemes which takes duration calls as per the interest rate cycle. So duration management is also key and is effectively managed by debt fund managers. So now that we have understood the four dimensions of risk management, let us see what is it that as an investor you can keep in mind or you need to watch out for before investing into a debt mutual fund scheme. Pick a scheme after going through their past track record on how they've managed risk. Ask the AMC about their risk management philosophy. Never chase only YTM or past returns because they can often be misleading. Assess interest rate cycle before investing in long maturity schemes. Read the scheme fact sheet. A scheme fact sheet contains all relevant information that you need to have to take a decision on investing into a fund. And often there is a lot of news that keeps floating around that could cause apprehension or tension in your mind. While of course you can do your own research, but it always helps that you reach out to your advisor or the mutual fund house to get clarity on all what you read or all what you hear from maybe somebody who has had a negative experience somewhere. So this is also extremely important for each of the investors to go through. Just a second, there's some technical problem. Yeah. So now that we've covered all the important factors, we started off with talking about the benefits of fixed income investing, how a mutual fund is positioned within the fixed income space, what are the advantages of investing through the mutual fund route. We then looked at the sources of debt fund returns, which is accrual income and capital appreciation. Then we moved on to discuss what are the different types of mutual fund schemes available for you as an investor to pick and choose based on your risk appetite, based on your return expectation, and based on your time horizon. Then we moved at the we understood the different dimensions or different aspects of risk management, and we also looked at the points that one as an investor needs to keep in mind before investing or before choosing the right debt fund. Debt funds are suitable for every kind of need that an investor could have and for every kind of risk, every risk appetite. There are debt mutual funds that would suit a very conservative investor, someone who is investing into a mutual fund scheme for the first time. There are debt mutual funds that would suit a risk-averse investor. There are debt mutual funds where you can park your money for only a few days. There are debt mutual funds where you can park your funds to eventually move money into, let's say, equity, mutual funds that suit retired investors, mutual funds that suit senior citizens. So you have mutual funds to cater to every need of yours. The flexibility to invest into mutual funds comes handy in the form of investing even in small amounts systematically through the SIP route as well. I would like to conclude by stating that in the current scenario, when equity valuations are not very cheap and when traditional debt instruments don't look as attractive in the current falling interest rate scenario, it definitely makes a strong case for investments into debt mutual funds. A lot of investors believe that mutual funds means only equity mutual funds, but there is debt mutual funds also, which offers a very good diversification from equity mutual funds. And we believe that that should be the foundation or that should be the central part of any investor's portfolio. So the question that each one of us should ask is, are you adequately invested in debt mutual funds? So with this, I would like to hand over the session to Ms. Radhika.
Thank you, Renu, for setting the stage with such an interesting presentation. It definitely gave us a broad perspective of debt funds. Thanks a lot. Let us take this session forward, and I would like to start with Warren Buffett's famous quote. I will tell you how to become rich. Close the doors. Be fearful when others are greedy. Be greedy when others are fearful. Warren Buffett also said, risk comes from not knowing what you're doing. While these pearls of wisdom apply to all investments in general, they particularly find a lot of relevance for debt fund investors in recent times. Either investors avoid debt funds altogether because of the complex jargons that are used in these schemes. You have duration, you have, you know, credit risk, you have accrual, all of that. So investors are often intimidated by such complex jargons. Or investors park money in debt funds with little or half the knowledge just to chase, mouth-watering returns, not knowing what really is driving them. So what are debt funds actually? How have they once, done spectacularly well in certain market phases? And why have they disappointed in certain times? What value do debt funds actually add to one's portfolio? And how can you keep your risk minimal while really earning stable and good returns over the long run? In this webinar today, we attempt to answer all these questions and tell you how to manage your debt funds more efficiently. I would now like to bring Piyush on board. Piyush, I want to kickstart with another one of my favorite quotes by Robert G. Allen, one of the famous American businessmen. He said, how many millionaires do you know who have become wealthy by investing in savings account? I rest my case. It is so relevant today because we have seen bank deposit rates fall so sharply. In fact, they are at almost 2-decade low levels. We saw these kind of rates, I think, back in 2003, 2004. And the other favorite fixed income, traditional fixed income options, like your post office savings, like PPF, NSE, etc., their rates are also at the level that we saw in 1992. So at this current context, you know, we have a lot of investors asking us that, you know, bank deposit rates are just not giving us enough return. I mean, forget about beating inflation. It's just not enough on a post-tax basis also. And hence, there is this question that whether debt funds are, you know, essential for your portfolio. If yes, what really are the advantages of having debt fund in one's portfolio? Renu spoke about, liquidity, stability, and all of that. If now we can just elaborate on 3-4 main aspects, why debt funds are really essential in one's portfolio. Piyush, if you could kickstart.
Yes, thank you, Radhika. So one of the key components for any portfolio construction is diversification. So like Renu mentioned in our presentation, debt as an asset class provides diversification to the overall portfolio. It adds stability to the overall portfolio. So in a way, overall risk-adjusted performance that you get from a diversified portfolio, which is a combination of multiple asset classes, it gives you a better, superior risk-adjusted return compared to a single asset class portfolio. So that is first thing. Now, second is, how do mutual funds fit in here? Now, mutual funds, we have various categories available. Now, debt is one of the larger component. If you look at even overall mutual fund industry AUM, and they offer multiple options from the investor perspective, and they cater to the specific needs of the investor. And it also caters to different market horizons or different market phases. So to that extent, debt mutual funds are definitely a superior option compared to other options available in the market. If we were to just compare the performance of the funds, like you mentioned, currently the interest rates are at a lower level, or the fixed deposit rates are at a very low level. Now, how does it compare with the mutual funds? If I were to look at, say, last 1 year or 3 years of performance, debt mutual funds in a short-term category, they have given a return of about 6.5% to 7%. During the same period, we saw that FD rates were hovering around 6% to 6.5%. So to that extent, these funds or the mutual funds definitely offer superior returns compared to traditional options which are available in the market. Of course, One needs to be aware that these are mark-to-market instruments. So to that extent, there will be volatility when you look at these funds. The other aspect which is positive from the mutual fund perspective, which also Renu in a presentation touched upon, is the superior tax benefit. If you are investing in debt mutual funds for more than 3 years, capital gains are applicable as far as the taxation is concerned. And if you are invested for more than 3 years, long-term capital gain tax is applicable. Now, how does it work? If you are invested for more than 3 years, the tax rate which is applicable is 20%. Over and above that, you can also avail the benefit of indexation. And what does indexation mean? You can, if you are invested for say 3 years and your return from the fund is say 8%, and during the investment period, if the inflation, average inflation during the period is say 4.5%, your gain is in a way adjusted to the inflation, and you effectively pay tax only to the incremental return, which is over and above 5%, which is 3%. So on 3% of the gain, you pay a tax of 20%. To that extent, it becomes much more superior option compared to a traditional option where the taxation is based on the tax bracket in which the investor falls in. If the investor falls in a highest tax bracket of 30 or 33%, that is the kind of tax that he will end up paying even if he's invested for more than 3 years. So this is the second benefit, I would say, compared to a traditional investment option. Third, of course, is the liquidity. Mutual funds, all the open-ended mutual funds are open for subscription and redemption on a daily basis. So basically, you can buy and redeem from the mutual fund on any working or market day. And to that extent, if you are invested in a traditional investments, you are locked in for a minimum time frame. For instance, if you are invested in an FD for 3 years, you are locked in for 3 years. And if you have to come out of FD, you have to pay some sort of a penalty, then you can come out of the FD investment. Compared to that, in case of a mutual fund, you can redeem at any point in time. If you are invested from a relatively longer time frame, even the exit loads are not applicable in most of the categories. So these are some of the benefits you have compared to traditional investment avenues which are available as far as the debt asset class is concerned.
Okay. So these are the advantages, of course. Like you mentioned, we have returns in favor of debt funds. We have liquidity. And then, of course, they are very tax efficient in comparison to your, plain Jane bank FDs and post office. I mean, post office, of course, they have their tax benefits,
yes.
But other fixed income options. It is not as simple as that, isn't it, Piyush? Because like you started the discussion with the point that it's mark to market, just to explain that a bit, we know that these are not, shielded from market risk. Just like, investing in equity funds where your NAVs can go up and down. Even in debt funds, your NAVs can go up and down. And we have, investors wondering, because there's always this confusion when you say fixed income, they always assume that just like your bank FD, even your investments in, debt funds are safe and, you can't see capital erosion and all of that. And as far as even capital appreciation, both sides. So if we can now, talk about what really drives the NAV of these debt funds, because only from then we can really carry forward the discussion. So what are the key factors, like Renu had also touched upon the interest rate and the credit risk. If we can just simplify that a little bit more on how really interest rates, why do they really impact certain debt funds, and why do credit risk actually impact debt funds?
So if I were to look at debt mutual funds, in fact, Renu covered that in her slide, there are two sources of return. One is the interest income, which is accrued in the fixed income security. And second is the capital appreciation. Now, let's go a step behind and then just try to understand how does a debt mutual fund function. So a debt mutual fund invests in a range of securities, which could be a bond or a CP or a CD, any kind of a fixed income instrument. Now, these instruments are coupon bearing instruments or interest bearing instruments. So you have an accrual which comes in these instruments. So they become, as they become part of the portfolio, any kind of accrual that happens in the underlying security also becomes part of the NAV. The second component is the capital appreciation or depreciation, which essentially adds to the volatility or results in the up and down movement of the NAV. Now, if you look at the fixed income security, like we mentioned, there are two components. One is the interest accrual, which happens in the security. Second is the expected yield from the portfolio, and which eventually determines the price of the bond. Now, what happens is, in a scenario where the interest rates are going down, the price of the security typically goes up, and which in a way adds to the overall capital appreciation of the bond and eventually into the NAV of the portfolio. Now, why does it happen? It is very counterintuitive, right? You have an interest rate going down. Why does the price of a bond? Why should the price of a bond go up? Now, I will explain it with the help of an example. You take a fixed income security with an 8% coupon, which you can accrue during the life of the bond. Now, in the current scenario, if the interest rates are at a level which is higher than, say, 8%, so which means this particular bond, which is giving you a coupon of 8%, is giving you a coupon which is lower than the overall interest rate scenario which is there in the market. So to that extent, the price of the bond or the demand for such security is lower in the market, and hence the price of the bond should go down. Similarly, if the, in the current interest rate scenario, if the interest rate is, say, around 6% or 5%, and the coupon which is being accrued from the security is 8%, there is a greater demand because this particular bond is giving you higher coupon compared to the general interest rate scenario which is prevailing in the market. So this basically explains the opposite correlation between the price and the yield. Now, how does the yield of the bond determine? Now, these are typically determined by the interest rate policy of RBI. They come out with their monetary policy on a regular basis, and which in a way determines the overall direction of the interest rate in the overall economy. Second is the liquidity situation in the market. If you have a high liquidity, typically the interest rates tend to go on the lower end, and which is in fact the case in the current scenario. The banks are flush with a good amount of liquidity or a good amount of money, and hence the overall interest rate tend to slide in a lower direction. So these are the two components which in a way determine the price of a bond. Now, there are multiple securities which are there in the portfolio. You will have securities which are high rated, like maybe a GSEC or a AAA. You may also have lower rated security. So to that extent, the coupon or the interest accrual on these securities will also vary. A security which has a higher rating, or maybe a government security where there is no credit risk, the coupon tends to be lower. And to that extent, even the yield on these securities tend to be lower. Compared to that, if you have a lower rated security like AA or AA plus or AA minus, because the credit rating is lower, the coupon which is offered to the investor is typically higher. And to that extent, there is an higher accrual that you will see in the lower rated securities. So in a nutshell, what you have is two components in the mutual fund returns. One is the interest accrual income, and second is the capital appreciation and depreciation, which may happen mainly on account of change in the interest rate scenario. The other thing is, if you were to compare this with the, say, traditional options like FD, there the source of return is only the interest coupon, and the capital appreciation depreciation doesn't happen. So that's a major difference between a traditional fixed income instrument compared to a mutual fund which is investing in bonds or CP and CD, where there's always a fluctuation in the price of the bond.
Yeah, Piyush, that was very helpful. So basically, we are saying that the NAV of debt funds is driven by both the interest rate So if interest rate and price movements of bonds basically are inversely related, and hence your NAVs can move up and down depending on the interest rate movements. And then we are saying that the credit risk, obviously, because your lower rated bonds would earn a higher coupon. So if you are willing to take a higher risk, then you know you can earn higher return. So basically, your credit risk also drives your NAVs. Of course, if there are defaults and downgrades, like Renu had mentioned, that also impacts the NAVs. So this, in a nutshell, kind of helps us determine how the NAV of debt funds, you know, move up and down.
So, Rajita, but just to add one more point here. The other component, which is a important component, is the duration of the portfolio or duration of the security. Now, what happens is, if a duration of a bond is longer, typically the yield on that bond is also higher, and it's primarily because of the interest rate uncertainty is more if you have a longer investment horizon in a fixed income security. So to that extent, the expected yield is also higher. What also happens is, for these longer duration bonds, the sensitivity to the change in the yield in the market is also higher. So if I'm looking at a 1 year security, if the interest rates were to go up by 100 basis point or go down by 100 basis point, the capital appreciation or depreciation that happens in that security will be lower compared to a security which is a 10 year security. So when we look at various categories of mutual funds, you'll find various duration buckets in which they play. What you'll find is a longer duration category or a longer duration fixed income instrument will tend to be more sensitive to the interest rate movement, and hence the capital appreciation and depreciation that you will see in those bonds will be much higher compared to a shorter tenor bond or shorter tenor mutual fund.
So Piyush, then just moving forward very quickly, now that we have the basics out of the way, and I'm sure that the investors want to get into, you know, these 16 categories of debt funds. While SEBI has neatly categorized them based on duration and, you know, the credit risk, they are still 16 categories, right? And there are over, you know, 40 mutual fund houses. So for an investor, let us just very quickly, though Renu had mentioned and she has categorized neatly the 16 categories of funds within several brackets, if we can quickly just kind of map them in a risk versus return kind of a metrics, you know, say, for example, which are the funds that could probably fall in the lower interest rate risk category, you know, and then moving up the funds that could probably fall in the higher interest rate category, but lower on credit risk, and vice versa. Yeah. If we can quickly map these 16 debt funds, then we can just take this discussion forward with, you know, more specific areas of concerns and opportunities. Yeah.
Yes. So, I'll broadly first classify the categories into three buckets. So there are certain categories, about 10 categories, which are primarily classified based on the duration bucket or the maturity bucket. You have starting from a lowest maturity, which is an overnight fund, where the maturity of the fund is typically 1 day. So they invest in securities which have a maturity of only 1 day. Then you have liquid fund category, where the investments can be done in the securities, where the average maturity of the portfolio typically is less than 3 months. So this is on the one side of the maturity spectrum. On the longer end, you have long duration category, where the investments are done into securities which are more than 7 years, or the average maturity of the portfolio is typically more than 7 years. So these are the two extremes when we look at that, the underlying maturity of the portfolio where the mutual fund invests. Of course, there are interim categories in this duration based category. You have ultra short duration, where the portfolio duration is typically from 3 to 6 months. For low duration, it is 6 to 12 months, and money market is up to 1 year. And so basically, they can maintain their portfolio in maturity ranging from 1 day to 365 days. Other than that, you have short duration funds where the maturity of the portfolio is from 1 to 3 years. And then you have medium duration and medium to long duration where the maturity is typically from 3 to 4 years and 4 to 7 years. So these are the various categories which are there. In addition to that, there is a dynamic bond category where the fund manager can manage the duration depending on the interest rate scenario, and he can have a duration as low as say 1 day and as I have say maybe 10 years or over and above that. So these are some of the categories which are available under the mutual fund category depending on the duration bucket. Then you have a second set of categories which are primarily defined based on the underlying credit risk in the portfolio. So there is one category which is the credit risk fund category where the investments are done primarily in the lower rated instruments which are AA and below. Now the minimum investment that has to be done in these category into such instrument is 65%. There is one more category which is an opposite of credit risk category, which is the corporate bond category, whereby the investments are done typically in the highest rated instruments, and such investments have to be at least 80% of the overall fund portfolio. Now, then you have other categories where the investments are done in a typical type of instrument, which is floating rate bonds or government securities, or you have a category which invests only in banking and PSU issuers. Now, you have these multiple options available. Now, each of these categories cater to the specific need of the investor. Now, if you have an investor who is wanting to invest for a short period of time, say maybe a temporary parking, he needs money maybe next 3 months or 6 months. Categories such as liquid fund, overnight fund, ultra short fund, these are some of the categories which can be used for such short-term instruments, short-term investments. Now, if you have a investment horizon which is slightly longer or maybe a medium term, up to say maybe 1 to 3 years or 3 to 4 years, that's where you look at categories such as short duration fund or medium duration funds. If you are having a longer investment horizon, then that's when you look at longer duration category like medium to long duration or long duration category. One key point I think that investor has to be aware of, at least when they look at long duration or medium to long duration fund, even for that matter, even dynamic bond fund, these categories are dependent or are quite sensitive to the interest rate cycle, which is what we discussed in our earlier discussion. So if you are expecting the interest rates to kind of ease or go down, then your long duration or medium to long duration or dynamic bond funds are the categories which will give you superior returns compared to short-term categories. Of course, here you need to have a very correct view in terms of how the interest rates are going to go forward, and then take a overall investment decision in these categories. Now, if you are looking for stable accrual income, then you have credit risk funds. Of course, the risk here is that the investments are done in securities which are relatively lower rated. So to that extent, there is always a risk of downgrade or a default which may happen in these categories. Corporate bond funds are the ones where if you have a lower risk appetite, you don't want to take exposure to lower rated instruments. Corporate bond category is the one which the investor can look at. Credit risk funds, of course, if you take a exposure to these categories, the accrual is also higher. If you don't have, say in a market scenario where you have a good economic condition and where there are more upgrades happening compared to downgrades, maybe a credit risk fund will fare better than the corporate bond category. But in a scenario where you have a weaker credit market, then maybe a corporate bond category is something which is a more suitable category from the investor perspective. Similarly, you have banking and PSU where the investments are typically done in banks and PSU. These are again the categories where the credit risk in the portfolio is typically lower than the otherwise created portfolio. In case you don't want to take any kind of a credit risk, then government securities or gilt category is the category one can look at. However, that doesn't mean that these categories cannot give negative returns. If the interest rates were to move in adverse direction, or if the interest rates were to go up, then even gilt funds can give you negative return. But these funds also have given very high return in a scenario when the interest rates have gone down historically.
Piyush, we have about more than 100 questions, so I want to take as many as possible. So just one last part of discussion, because let's get this out of the way. We are saying that there are funds, like you mentioned, liquid funds, overnight funds, short duration, ultra short duration funds. All this basically carry lower interest rate. So if there is a person who is looking to invest for a very short period of time, then he can look at these funds, because they do carry lower interest rate risk. Now, the problem is that we have seen experiences of investors where they have also seen negative returns in these funds, despite lower rate risk volatility. We have seen cases where, liquid funds, they've had some, credit defaults and credit downgrades and all that. So while the SEBI's categorization is clear on the duration part for these funds, and investors can say that, yes, rate risk is, capped to a large extent, but they do face credit risk. On the same end, like you were mentioning, corporate bond and PSU banking and debt funds, while the SEBI mandate says that the chunk of the investments has to be in high quality bonds, so your credit risk is capped to some extent. But then there again, there is a aspect of duration risk, because SEBI does not really mandate the kind of maturity or duration that these funds need to hold. So across categories, while generally the notion is that, these categories of funds have low rate risk, these categories of funds have, low credit risk, within the entire gamut of these funds, as people construct their portfolios, they do find risk crops up from somewhere or the other. So how does one really ensure that they can minimize risk? How does one understand how to read the portfolio in terms of disclosures? Maybe just 3 or 4 points, Piyush, very quickly before we take specific questions. Yeah.
So, like we discussed, the risk which is typically there in a fixed income portfolio is, one is the credit risk, second is the interest rate risk. Third is the liquidity risk in the portfolio. And the fourth component, which in fact we have not discussed, is the concentration risk in the portfolio. Now, credit risk is something that we already discussed. You have a possibility of a downgrade or a default in the security, if it's a corporate bond or a CP or a CD. And to that extent, the NAV can go down. Now here, one important factor that investor has to look at is the underlying portfolio. Renu mentioned that mutual funds typically disclose their portfolio on a monthly basis. Now, after 1st October, in fact, you will have a scenario whereby the portfolio will be given out on a fortnightly basis. Now, investor has to look at the underlying portfolio on an ongoing basis, look at what is the sort of rating profile which is there in the portfolio. And if at all there are any investments which are in the lower rated segment, to which the investor, one of the investors, is not probably comfortable with, then he needs to take a decision or maybe review his portfolio more proactively. The second component is the interest rate risk. Now, if I'm expecting that going forward, interest rates are going to go up, and there is a fund which is there in my portfolio which carries high duration in the portfolio, then that is a fund which probably can be adversely impacted as we move ahead. So the second component is the duration of the portfolio. Now again, factories do provide duration of a portfolio which is being maintained by the fund. One can look at the factory, look at the duration which is given in the factory to take a decision. Third component, which is the liquidity. What you have is typically in India, you have a very high correlation of liquidity with the rating of the instrument. What you typically find is a higher rated instrument has a high liquidity in the portfolio, while a lower rated instrument typically will have a lower liquidity when it comes to the secondary market. Now, if there is a higher chunk of lower liquid papers or with the papers which are not very liquid in the market, then that is a portfolio that one needs to review and take a corrective action. The fourth component is where all of this risk actually come together. Now, concentration is a critical component. You take two portfolios, one portfolio with exposure to a single issuer, which is say 10% compared to a second portfolio where the exposure is only say maybe 5% or 3%. Now, if that issuer witnesses a downgrade, then the impact on the portfolio which has 10% exposure to that issuer will be much higher compared to the second portfolio. So it's important to look at the diversification in the underlying portfolio. The portfolio which has a more diversified portfolio, a more limited exposure to lower rated instruments, those are something which are superior compared to a more concentrated portfolio. So these are four risks that the one has to look at when they are evaluating their funds and take a final decision.
Thanks, Piyush. Before we take the Q&A, a quick roundup of what you said. I mean, for investors out there, if in a particular category, a particular scheme is showing unbelievable returns, definitely then you must dig deeper into the portfolio to see why that specific fund in that category is giving much above returns than the category average. That could be one red flag for investors to check the portfolio on all the aspects that Piyush just spoke about. Quickly, before we go to the Q&A round, I would request Renu to run the disclaimer slides and then we'll quickly go on to the Q&A session. It is important that investors, just like your bank FD, also have nominations in place when they are investing in mutual funds. That is also very, very essential to avoid any, you know, untoward, you know, confusion later on. And it is always, you know, better that, you know, your KYC is done fully and you know, you're following all the compliance. Above all, of course, all mutual funds should, all investors should read the mutual fund document very carefully before they, you know, invest in various schemes and not follow what others are following. That's very important. As we are wary about investing or doing so many other things in our, you know, day-to-day financial activities, so also when we are investing, we must kind of read all the documents very carefully before we invest. Go with a reliable advisor, you know, who could probably guide you through the entire process very seamlessly and give you a more, efficient pick of choices for funds that suit your risk and your investment horizon and goals. So that will be very important also to note. So we are back, Piyush and Renu. Now we're going to take, we've got so many questions, so, and they're very, very good questions. It's very happy to note that investors have become very savvy over the last, 3 to 4 years. They often kind of bowl you over with the kind of questions that they have. So let's start off. We have this one question from Raj Deshmukh. He says that gilt funds versus low duration funds. Now, both invest in government securities. So where is the difference and how does one understand whether to invest in gilt funds or low duration funds? Piyush, you'd like to take that?
Yes. So the low duration funds are the funds which invest into securities, which typically the maturity is between say 6 to 12 months. So that's the maturity with which the low duration funds are constructed in terms of portfolio. Gilt funds are the funds which invest in government securities. Now, government securities are typically long-term in nature. If you are investing for a shorter investment horizon, that's when the low duration fund is something which will be more appropriate. If you are, see, there are times when people have a particular goal in their mind. For
we lost Piyush for a bit there. I think we'll wait for him to connect back. So I think I could probably step in on what he was talking about, and even Renu could add to that. So basically, he was talking about how gilt funds invest in long duration, securities, and low duration funds invest in securities that have a shorter maturity. So obviously, by now, from the discussion that we have had, it has now become evident that shorter duration securities are less sensitive to interest rate movements. And hence, you see a lower rate risk on low duration funds vis-a-vis gilt funds. So gilt funds carry in their portfolio a longer, securities with longer G-Secs. And hence, they generate higher return, but with a higher interest rate risk. And hence, if you have a longer term horizon of say 5-6 years, then gilt funds are advisable. If you have a very short duration of 3 to 6 months, then you can go for low duration or ultra bond funds. Let's go to the next question while we wait for Piyush to join in. We have this question from Manoharan Narayan Swami. He says that side pocketing of bad debts by various schemes are increasing, and there are closure of funds posing threats, and debt funds are looking quite risky. Now, what will bring back the confidence for an investor? How does an investor stay safe or carry minimal risk while investing in debt funds? I think we have Piyush back. Piyush, you'd like to take that question?
Yeah, so am I audible?
Yeah, you are. Yeah, go ahead.
So what we discussed earlier also, it's important to be aware of the risk which are there in the portfolio, all the four risks that we spoke about. Second, also one needs to be aware about or needs to construct a portfolio, keeping in mind his risk appetite and the investment horizon. Now, side pocketing has happened primarily because of the default in some of the securities which were part of the portfolio. Now, this is something which is critical from the perspective of monitoring the credit risk in the portfolio. If you are looking at the underlying portfolio, if there are any investments which are in lower rated segment or in some companies which are not from the perspective of the overall credit quality, they are weaker, then you need to relook at the portfolio or reposition your portfolio. So it is important, like we mentioned earlier, it's important to understand the underlying risk in the portfolio, understand your risk appetite. If you are not willing to take any kind of a credit risk, then some of the categories like corporate bond fund, banking PSU are the categories one needs to look at, and also continuously monitor the underlying portfolio. That is very critical in order to avoid any such instances.
Okay. Piyush, there is a very interesting question, actually, which also I wanted to touch upon. Vishwanath Krishnaswamy says that most of the time, at the time of investing, we see in the portfolio, there are mostly AAA securities. So we find comfort from the fact that they are holding high quality debt papers, the credit risk is low. But over a period of time, the composition changes. And how do you keep track of it? To add to that, there is another question that had come up from our readers sometime back. We have, within the portfolio, we have so many bonds which are, we can't understand the nature of those bonds, like structured obligations, etc., which are too complex for a retail investor to understand. So when we look at the portfolio, one, what Vishwanath Krishnaswamy is asking, how do we constantly monitor, every month do we monitor, and what happens midway, you know, if you're not able to keep track and suddenly the composition changes, we see higher exposure to low quality papers. And then the second aspect, and how do we keep track of all these complex instruments in the portfolio?
Yeah, so should I take this question?
Yes, yes, please.
So, see, I understand you can have multiple portfolio composition. In a sense, you may have a AAA rated portfolio, but over a period of time, the downgrade happens, and then you wonder what is to be done. See, if there is a downgrade which happens, see, what you typically have is when you look at the default and transition stats of various rating category, what you will find is that a AAA rated instrument typically has a lower downgrade rate or a default rate compared to a lower rated instrument. So if even if your investment goes down from say AAA to AA plus, generally the impact on the portfolio is not so much, in a sense, because the yields would have hardened to a lower extent compared to a downgrade which would have happened from say AA to say AA minus or A rated category, where the impact could be higher. So it's important to monitor the portfolio continuously, look at how the portfolio is transitioning on a month-on-month basis as we move ahead. In order to understand the underlying structure of the paper, I think it is something where you will need to go a little deep into it. You need to understand what are the covenants which are there in these structured instruments. What is the sort of rating guarantee? So you, what sort of structured papers you have? You have some guaranteed papers where the guarantee is given by a bank or a financial institution. So you need to understand who is the guarantor, what is the sort of rating which is there for that guarantor, which in a way will give you a good sense if it is guaranteed by SBI, the nature of guarantee which is there, whether it is fully unconditional guarantee which is given by that guarantor. All these elements are critical to understand these structured instruments. Apart from that, you have various instruments like annuity projects, where the major source of income is, for instance, in a road project, the major source of income is toll, toll collection. Now, in such instrument, one also needs to understand the current economic situation. For instance, if I were to look at in today's scenario, any road project is likely to get adversely impacted, given that you have a lockdown for the last 6 months. There is very limited activity which is happening on the economic front. So it's also important to understand the sector in which that particular company operates, or the nature of the structure which is there in that structured instrument, and then take a call. So, and again here, if I were to look at it, it's also important to consult the advisor you have, because he's the one who is also tracking the market. Understand from him what is the sort of portfolio is there in the in your mutual fund scheme. Understand the nuances and then take a call.
Okay. Renu, if you can have you on board, we have two interesting questions from Swaminathan. He talks about, he has two queries. One is, what is the ideal time duration for debt fund investment, especially for retail investors? That's a very broad question he's asking. More specifically, he's asking that if he has a time horizon of 4 to 6 months, which category of funds should he look at? Renu, would you like to take that?
Yes, David. So the beauty of debt investments is that, you know, you have products where you can invest for as low as 1 day, and you can invest for as many years as you would like to. You know, we've come across investors, you've invested in a debt scheme for as long as 20 years as well. So you have products which are suitable for different time horizons. Now, to answer your specific question on which is the category where you can invest for 3 to 4 months, for a retail investor to reduce any sort of interest rate risk is if you can match the duration of your investment time horizon with the duration of the underlying securities of the fund. So for a 3 to 4 months time duration, I think the ultra short duration would be the ideal fund. Of course, there are funds where you can take a call to invest for these time periods, but I would suggest that, you know, for that you would ideally take advice from your investment advisor to see your overall risk appetite, etc. A lot of other elements as well come into the picture before you take a decision. But a broad answer would be the ultra short duration category. And Radhika, if I can just add on to what Piyush spoke on the previous question, right, in terms of, you know, how does an investor be aware of what happens in terms of the changes in portfolio? So just two points to add on is that one is that mutual fund is a highly regulated industry. So, you know, you will not be in for a surprise or a shock if you actually understand the complete nuances, as Piyush said, before you make the investment. So it is... if we read the investment objective of the scheme, we will definitely understand the scope of credit exposure that each fund can take, which will definitely help the investor to know the kind of risk and analyze the risk reward benefits before you choose a specific fund. So ideally, there is no, I mean, we would not have come across experiences that investors would have had where the underlying securities would have diametrically changed from month to month or, you know, over a period of time. So fund managers generally invest as per the investment objective of the scheme. So it is very important that we understand what we are getting into before we put our money.
Fair enough. I mean, like I said, it's like the buyer beware caveat always. I mean, the investor must pour through all the documents. And if you're not able to understand, you have to reach out to advisors or exactly. people who can kind of guide you better.
Exactly.
Renu, probably this question also you can take. There is one question from Golak Mehkap. He says that amid the falling interest rate scenario right now, which debt funds should investors go for?
Okay. So if I can draw inference from what I spoke in the beginning, in a falling interest rate scenario, we should invest into funds which invest into instruments which gain out of or which are very sensitive to interest rate movements. Say, for example, funds which have G-Sec exposure to government securities, funds which have exposure to AAA securities, because these are the instruments where the impact happens more pronounced than in rest of the securities. So to take advantage of falling interest rate scenario, see, one, as a retail investor, it is extremely important to time the market if you are purely looking at gaining capital appreciation. If I assume that you have enough information about the risk and rewards of each of these categories, maybe one of the best categories where you can get benefit of a falling interest rate scenario would be a gilt fund. But then it is extremely important that you enter at the right time and you exit at the right time, which doesn't happen in all the in the case of all investors. So maybe you could look at a AAA oriented fund, a medium duration or a medium to long duration AAA oriented fund as well to take advantage of the falling interest rates.
And in any case, I think, I mean, gilt funds, we have said that they are higher on the interest rate risk. So yes, you can make, you can draw benefit from the falling interest rate, but you must be willing to take higher risk as well going forward. The volatility right. also is something that you should be.
Yeah, you should be in a position to exit before the interest rate cycle reverses.
Right. Piyush, there are two, three questions from retired people. It's very interesting because we have seen that, you know, for retirees, especially the falling bank deposit rates have hit them pretty hard because they passively, I mean, they depend on these interest income that comes from bank deposit rates. And hence, they're looking at alternatives where they can, you know, add the spunk to their returns and kind of draw benefit from debt funds. So we have this question from Alok Bhattacharya, who says that for a retired person, which are the funds that are suitable? Maybe Renu and Piyush both can address this question.
So maybe I'll start. If you are looking at focusing on maybe a steady income or steady accrual of returns, then maybe look at a category like short duration fund. Given provided you have a investment horizon which is about maybe 1 to 3 year or at least 3 year or so. If you are looking at regular income, then maybe you can always opt for the dividend option in these categories. So just to get the regular income as part of your overall investment. Definitely, like Renu mentioned earlier, categories such as long duration, gilt fund, these are to be avoided because they are highly cyclical and their performance will largely depend on the interest rate scenario. So if you are looking at steady income, look at short duration oriented funds, like short duration fund or maybe ultra short or money market fund. If you have a very short investment horizon, then look at these money market oriented fund. But if you have a 1 to 3 year horizon, then look at a short duration fund.
Okay. Renu, you'd like to add to that?
Pretty much the same. So assuming that a retired investor would like to preserve his wealth and not want to take much of risk in terms of price volatility, it is definitely the short duration conservative funds that would be more suited. And if there is a requirement, that is in terms of fund selection. And as Piyush said, if there is a requirement of regular cash flows from these investments, you may choose the dividend option, or you may even go for the systematic withdrawal plan. In fact, you have multiple flexibilities when it comes to taking taking inflows from the scheme that you have invested in. So any of these short duration, stable return oriented funds would be more suitable. But at the end of the day, when we are answering these questions, couple of elements that we are not aware is if you are getting further income, what is the kind of risk appetite that you have, etc. So these are unknown elements as we answer, but stable short duration funds would definitely be suitable for retired investors.
Okay. There is this interesting question on PSU banking and debt fund. Actually, Sebal Bhattacharya is asking whether it's a good time to invest in banking and PSU debt fund if he has a time horizon of 1 to 1.5 years. There is another one from an anonymous attendee. We don't know his name, his or her name. He's talking about the risks that he has seen in some of the banking and PSU debt funds. Very short, but because of investments in, 81 bonds, like we saw the episode with Yes Bank. So after that, a lot of investors are kind of worried whether these investments that the banking and PSU debt funds hold, do we have to be worried about them? Because most of the banking and PSU debt funds hold 81 bonds of various banks. So maybe Piyush can start off and then Renu can also add on to that.
Yeah, so I think it's important to understand the nature of 81 bonds. They are not like the regular bonds which you have where there is a regular income or the coupon that it gets accrued. Here, in case of 81, if the credit profile of the bank deteriorates and the financials weaken significantly, in case of 81 bonds, there is always an option for the bank not to pay coupon under those situations. Also, one needs to remember these are extremely extreme situations. So, Yes Bank again was an extreme situation which you will not see very often. But of course, in terms of the risk profile of the instrument, which is 81, it is not same as what you have in a regular vanilla bond where the coupon is typically accrues, and here there is always a conditionality in terms of payment of coupon. So to that extent, these bonds are definitely more risky compared to the other bonds. And when you are investing in banking and PSU and you're not comfortable with this sort of a risk, maybe you may want to avoid such funds. So again, it's important to look at the underlying portfolio before investing. So
Renu, you'd like to add to that?
Yeah, just to add on, banking and PSU, as a category is definitely a category which is in demand right now. But as Piyush said, it is extremely important that we understand how the specific fund is run. Okay, as a category, the SEBI definition only says that you have to predominantly invest into banks and PSUs, right? But each fund house can follow different methodologies in terms of running it. Maybe somebody would be running it passively, somebody would be doing an active management. So the strategies would differ. So we need to understand how each fund is run individually. That's point number one. Point number two, as you said, 81 bonds, just because something, a particular incident happened with one particular issuer doesn't mean that all such instruments are at risk. So we need to understand the risks associated with the primarily the issuer. So my broad understanding is that if you are investing into securities large banks, etc., the risk could be limited. So we need to do the risk reward analysis. But banking PSU as a category is definitely something that investors are definitely interested in, and if it suits your risk profile and your investment time horizon, is something that you could definitely look at investing.
Okay. There is this interesting question. Maybe Renu can take this, because you spoke at length about the indexation benefit. We have this question from Loganathan Shanmugan and also Badrinarayanan, who is saying that indexation benefit appears to be useful for investors who are in the higher tax bracket, 30% and above. Do they really, make that much of a difference, or do they add value to investors in the lower income slab as well, who are in probably 10% kind of a tax slab? Does it help them as well?
Mm-hmm. To give clarity on indexation benefit, so indexation benefit in debt mutual funds is something that you avail of. In fact, it is not an option. It is something that is a given today as per the current tax structure. Is that any investor who invests into a debt mutual fund and stays invested for 3 years or more definitely gets taxed at long-term capital gain. The gain is treated as long-term capital gains, and the tax rate is 20% with indexation. So indexation definitely comes as an added feature in the way the tax is calculated today. So there was a time when there was an option whether you would want to go in for indexation benefit or you would want to get taxed without indexation benefit. But today, for all long-term investors, which is 3 years or more, indexation is definitely something that comes with long-term investments. If the investment. So there is no choice, and it doesn't matter whether you are a retail investor or an HNI investor.
Okay. I want to take one last question, because this is a fund category which is very less spoken about. We have this person who has asked this question. Of course, we don't know his name. They're asking, what is floater debt fund? It is there in one of those 16 categories of debt funds. And we often seen that in most of the discussions, we kind of don't talk about it much. It is a very less covered kind of a debt scheme. So maybe Renu, if you want to talk about it, or if Piyush can probably explain what is a floater debt fund.
Yeah, so maybe I can start.
Yeah.
Before getting into the category, let's understand the instrument. So you have these floating rate instruments. You have a vanilla bond, which is, for instance, a bond which is issued at 100 rupees at the time of inception. And it says that the 8% coupon is something which is going to be paid out during the tenure of the bond. So if it is a 5-year bond, 8% every year is something which is a coupon which is paid out by the bond. Now, here you have a fixed coupon which is being paid out during the tenure of the bond. Floating rate bond are slightly different. The way they work is the coupon which is paid out gets reset at a regular frequency, for instance, 6 months. So at the end of 6 months, the interest coupon that is going to be paid out in the subsequent 6 month period is typically determined by the interest rate that is prevailing at that point in time. So to that extent, the interest coupon which is accrued from these instruments depend on the market rate scenario. Now, if you have a market scenario whereby the interest rates are going up, you will have these floating rate instruments accruing higher income during the term of the bond. On the contrary, if the interest rates were to go down, they will accrue lower coupon income during the horizon of the bond. Now, in a way, what is happening with the floating rate bond is they are in a way hedging the interest rate movement. In the market. If the interest rates were to go up, you have a higher income. If the interest rates were to go down, then you have a lower interest income. Okay. Something similar to a floating rate home loan that you typically have. So these are the instruments where these floating rate categories typically invest. And these are, if you look at the duration of these bonds are typically, or rather these categories will be around 1 to 3 years. technically, if you were to look at them, if the reset happens every 6 months for the bonds, then the duration of that bond also to some extent is around 6 months, because every 6 months there is a reset which is happening in the underlying portfolio. But again, resets may happen at different points in time. So to that extent, there will be that difference in the overall.
Yeah. So Piyush, so what kind of investors should go for it? Ones who are, who have a moderate risk appetite, conservative, or are willing to take the volatility? Will the returns be very volatile? What kind of investors should opt for these funds? Because they're not recommended very often. Like the investor has asked, which kind of investors do these funds really
serve? Volatility in these bonds will be typically lower compared to, and primarily because of the hedging or the natural hedge which happens in these bonds or the underlying bonds of these portfolio. You will not have a volatility that you will see in maybe a medium or medium to long or long duration bonds. So to that extent, a conservative or a moderate investors can definitely look at these categories.
That's all we have time for, though we have so many questions. Now we have over 200 questions piled up. I wish we could take each one of them, but we're completely run out of time. But all the investors who have logged in, the participants, we do request them to send their queries to us or even the ICICI Pru MF team. We would be happy to answer all your queries. It has been wonderful session, Piyush, Renu. I would really like to thank both of you. I think we covered as much as possible in the limited time that we had, and we took a lot of questions also from our participants. Thank you so much, Piyush, and thank you, Renu, for joining in today. I hope the investors gained a lot from this webinar.
Thank you, Radhika.